please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Hello and welcome to Taking Stock, the show where we bring you all the details of what happened in the markets in the past week. It has been a difficult week for the markets. With me is Sonia Shenoy. Hi, Sonia.
Hi, Lata. Yes, difficult week for the markets, but all in all, you know, the Nifty and the Sensex rose about 1%. So there was a tad bit of recovery. And of course, global cues have also been a bit subdued, right? Crude has been surging quite a bit. So many things to reckon with this week.
Oh, absolutely. I think the global cues were kind of ebbing and flowing. We got news of a huge fall in the global markets over the weekend on Friday, and then again on Monday, news that probably there
trade
is
trade war concerns.
Yeah, that there are some peace talks between Korea and US on the one hand, South Korean exports probably getting some kind of a leeway, and once again China talks with China as well to abate the trade war. But we still have after all these talks, the market's not able to rise. And a second set of problems from the FANG stocks, which are also impacting global markets. And separately, of course, in India, we have problems with the banking sector simply getting one bad news after the other.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, by the end of the year, we've put an end to FY18. By the end of the year, the Nifty and the Sensex are up 11%, so there's still gains there. And a lot of domestic stocks, you know, Maruti, HUL, L&T, have done very well this year. But joining us now to give us a sense of how to approach the week to come, as well as a view on the fundamentals, Mitesh Thakkar with his view on the technicals, as well as to answer all your stock-specific queries, we have Dhiraj Sachdev, who joins in as well. Let me start with Mitesh. Mitesh, what did you make of the market move? All in all, we saw a gain of around 1-odd% on the Nifty and the Sensex, but very treacherous week. How would you approach next week?
Yeah, good evening, Sonia. I think a very volatile week. But what is important is that with the movement last week, I think we've confirmed that 99.50 is some kind of a short-term bottom. We bounced back to about 10,200 levels and then tapered off from there. As long as we stay about 10,100, I think we should be slightly positive. Else, if we break 10,100, and I think the Nifty is close right there, then I think it might be a retest of 99.50 odd levels. I'm not looking to break below it, but that level can be retested. And then we might do a range of about 99.50 to about 10,230 for the next few days to come by.
Okay. Mitesh, anything specific about the Nifty Bank? It was kind of an underperformer, and the PSU banks even worse. You think those trends are likely to continue, or even over there is a bottom in sight?
I think that now is the time when possibly there are first signals of or green shoots of PSU banking stocks at least making a short-term low. I think most of these stocks have declined a lot. They're extremely oversold. And now they're not falling on increasingly bad news. So I think, you know, we've had some bad news in the last 2 days as well. But we didn't see these stocks make a fresh low. In fact, I'm looking at some kind of consolidation. State Bank of India around 240, 245 should be a very good buy. Keep a stop below 230. I think it can possibly bounce back to about 270, 275.
Okay.
Similarly, Bank of Baroda also looks very good if it manages to get past 147, 148 level.
Okay, I have just one final question for you. ICICI Bank, have you looked at the charts? Is there anything specific you have as a pattern?
I did see the coverage of ICICI Bank, which you had right now. Nothing much out there. In fact, it might have a mild negative opening based upon these news flows, but I'm not sure they're substantiated. So I think it might just continue what it's been doing for the last few weeks. Is basically broadly range-bound between 270, 280 on the lower side, about 310, 315 on the upper side.
Okay, well, we also have Dhiraj Sachdev waiting by. So, Mitesh, just request you to stay on for a tad bit. Dhiraj, hi. Welcome to the show. What's the sense you're getting about whether retail investors should now put fresh money into the market after the 10% fall that we've seen? Or do you think that there could be more to go and you should sit on cash right now?
Yeah, hi, Sonia. So, in the last 2 months, we have seen a fairly healthy correction from the market. And especially on the segment as far as the mid and small cap side is concerned, individual companies have corrected by at least 10%, 15%, and as high as 30, 35% as well. So the nervousness has largely been led by whether it's a US bond yields increases or interest rates hike or PSU bank governance issues in India or the excesses of the valuations of the preceding rally getting corrected. But from here on, since you asked the question from the retail investors' point of view, we need to take a step back and learn lessons from history. If I have to go back as far as 2003-2007 period, which was a raging bull market, we had 13 corrections of more than 10%. Post that, we had Lehman crisis, we had 2012 euro crisis, and we had even 2015 where the China slowdown or deflation scare, where our markets corrected by more than 20%, which lasted for only about 4 months or so. So every time we have seen in the past that corrections are great investment times or great entry points for the retail investors. Even the demonetization scare of late 2016 lasted for only 2 months. So my point is that corrections in the structural bull market are an opportunity in disguise. They may be short-lived. So from that perspective, we believe that the risk-reward equation appears to be far better.
Okay.
On the macro side, while some of the numbers are deteriorating on the fiscal slippages or current account deficit, but when I look at the micro side of the market, the corporate earnings are fairly encouraging.
Mm.
We saw the December numbers of Nifty growing by about 13%. And our estimates are that coming from a low base of last year, the earnings growth over the next 2 years can be as high as 18 to 20%. And also one fact is very important, and especially in the last 15, 20 years of historical perspective, that whenever you have an election time, the last 2 years, the IIP numbers and the GDP growth tends to improve. And we are in that sweet spot over the next 4 or 6 quarters. We might actually see accelerated government spending in the form of rural spending or agri spending or infrastructure spending.
Fair enough.
So net-net, we believe the risk-reward equation is a fairly positive.
Oh, that's good to hear. Both technically, the market's probably finding a bottom at 9950, and Dheeraj saying that even fundamentally, both micros and macros are probably on a better wicket. Mitesh, before we let you go, anything you would advise by way of specific stocks?
Yeah, so I have two recommendations, Lata. One on the buy and one on the sell side. Berger Paints had some kind of a short-term breakout on Wednesday, so I think that's a buy with a stop at 250. Look for a trading pop, bounce back to about levels of 270, 275. And a sell call on Federal Bank, if it breaks the recent consolidation, has been doing a range of about 89 to about 98. So if it breaks 89, go short with a stop at 91. Look for 85 to 84 on the downside.
All right. We'll let you go on that note, Mitesh, and allow you to enjoy the rest of the holiday weekend.
Okay. Well, those are some technical ideas, right? But what about the fundamentals? Dheeraj, you just mentioned that perhaps this is a good time to be buying into the market. At least the risk-reward looks favorable. Where would you put your money? Because this year, the banks have fallen the most. SBI, ICICI Bank, all down about 15-20%. Is that a good spot, or do you think that there are other better or lucrative opportunities?
So, Sonia, I think if you look at the mid-side and the small-cap side of the market, I think you have diversified opportunities which are available. So, our portfolio comprises of businesses which are in the agrochemical space, specialty chemical space, NBFCs which are into either the commercial vehicle side of lending or the housing finance or the microfinance or the gold mortgage finance business, stockbroking. You have print media where the valuations are still attractive. You have aqua business. So I think a host of themes which are available to choose from, and many of these businesses are fairly scalable and capital efficient in nature. Take for example, agrochemical business. Now, there are a variety of companies, whether it's a seed company or a farm equipment business, because a new generation of farmer doesn't want to work on fields. So farm equipment or farm mechanization is a great business opportunity over time. You have crop protection business, because given the food prices, the farmers are under greater pressure to improve crop yields. So crop protection products, like whether it's herbicide or pesticides, etc., offer great opportunity. Remember, the government focus over the next few quarters will be to revive the agriculture income. So this business augurs well, and it's a $6 to $7 billion business growing in India at about 12 to 13%. So we remain fairly bullish on agrochemical side of the business. Besides, we also like and have a few companies in the portfolio which are like specialty chemicals. Now again, if you actually look at it, because of the environment pollution norms in China, which is getting stringent day by day, that business is getting shifted to a lot of Indian companies. And again, this is a very scalable business, very capital efficient, and most of the Indian companies have demonstrated chemistry skills. And if I have to compare this, these are the businesses which are like pharma business 15 years back, and actually they can become, you know, over a period of time, fairly big compounding businesses, large businesses over time. And most of the chemicals are being supplied to global agrochemical companies, global pharma companies, global dyes and textile companies. So we are fairly positive on the both agrochemicals and the specialty chemical space as far as India business is concerned.
Okay, that's an exhaustive list that you've put before us, Dheeraj, but we still have questions. We are going to come back to you with more questions after this very short break. But then as we take that break, let's also give you more opinion from other experts we spoke through the day. Okay, that'll come to us after the break. Welcome back to Taking Stock. Well, we have to take stock of the situation in ICICI Bank. The ICICI Bank chairman, Mr. M.K. Sharma, addressed the press on the CEO, Chanda Kochhar's relation with Videocon, the row that has been now in all media and social media. He defended the bank chairman, Chanda Kochhar, and said that all rumours related to her husband's involvement are malicious and unfounded.
Really, they're telling you that 64 crore rupees matter, we don't know. Videocon Industries Limited or Videocon Group has not given any 64 crore investment in whatever company's name you call.
So I would say that when Mr. Dhoot says that he did not know, but I very much doubt that the two directors of the group company of Videocon, who have been associated with many Videocon companies, would still continue to be director of the company if the company was not belonging to Mr. Dhoot.
Okay, well, that's the issue with respect to ICICI Bank. Dheeraj, what do you do with some of these banks? You know, because this whole bank scam issue has become really big now. Is it a time to sort of venture into names like maybe SBI, which have fallen about 20-odd%? ICICI Bank has fallen quite a bit. We spoke about it before the break as well. But particularly with respect to this bank scam issue, you think the worst is over or is there more to go?
Well, Sonia, if you actually look at the banking segment in India, it can be divided into three parts. You have the PSU bank players, you have the private bank players, and you have the NBFC lenders. Now, PSU banks, if you actually look at it, they are structurally on a weaker wicket. The cost-to-income ratios are probably pretty high. They have past legacy issues on as far as the lending book is concerned. And I think it is still not the end of the NPA cycle. So while you may have dead cat bounces, but the problem is this, unless the structural issues are resolved as far as the high cost to income ratio, pension liabilities, and also all the restructured book is completely written off. We hope that they are written off over the next one or two quarters, but looks like, you know, they can have still leeway to provide provisions on those legacy loans for the next three or four quarters. We don't really see as a great investment opportunity as far as PSU banks are concerned. They may have bounces in between, but I think those could be short-lived unless the structural issues are resolved. On the private banks, yes, there are, again, within that you have retail lending banks and those which are also in the corporate lending. Even the corporate lenders have past legacy issues and they have still not fully provided for or accounted for. But maybe they are in the end of the recognition problem as far as the recognition of NPA is concerned. And then the beginning of a resolution cycle. Almost 1,40,000 crore of resolution on the steel and the power assets as far as NPA is concerned is getting resolved. And that's a very big positive. So probably private banks can be looked at. But on the other hand, you have the NBFC, which is fairly efficiently run, and they are taking away market share from both PSU banks especially, as well as private banks. And in the mid-cap side of the market, we are largely exposed to NBFCs across the verticals, be it on the housing side, on the commercial vehicle side, on the microfinance side, on the gold mortgage finance side, etc., etc. So I think these are the NBFCs where we believe the scalability is pretty high, the cost-to-income ratio is lower, the lending book is growing. Only at the margin, that's a pass-on kind of a phenomena.
All right. Dheeraj Sachdev, thank you very much for joining us with your thoughts on all these issues. That's one opinion coming in that both the micros and the macros for the market could actually start improving from here on. And of course, we heard the technical view from Mitesh as well.
And also the important part is, despite some of these PSU banks falling about 20%, nobody wants to go out and buy them because they believe that the worst is not over yet.
No, I'm not surprised with that, because there will be a lot of NPA recognition because of the new rules from the Reserve Bank. And therefore, you know, our colleague Tim C was also reporting that they have not paid any tax for the fourth quarter.
Yeah.
Probably even companies like Axis have paid no or nil tax or very low tax. Mm. So indicating that corporate-facing banks are going to have a problem fourth quarter. So it's only after the fourth quarter numbers are known that perhaps people will start taking an investment view. Yeah. We will really have to cross. I'm not surprised with what Dheeraj is telling us. They want to want that to cross. But now NBFCs have once again become favourites after that dip in the bond yields. Mm. Well, that was the word coming in from HSBC's asset management company. Let's listen into some more market opinion that we got earlier in the week. This one is from N. Jayakumar of Prime Securities. He believes there are signs of macroeconomic stability, but the Nifty will continue to test 10,000 every once in a way.
Maybe we will have tests of below 10,000 once in a while. And I think at the 9750, 10,000 range, maybe there will be fair amounts of spring back bargain hunting. You've seen, in fact, in this scenario, FIs continue to sell. So I think that hasn't changed. For most people, markets are still a tad expensive from an FI perspective. I do believe that there are some signs of macro stability, at least on the interest rate factors. Oil continues to be a worry. I think in many cases, the bidders are bidding not for companies, but for the assets. So you need to be a bit careful. Undeniably, the only space that's growing at double digits and serious double digits is the aviation space. And I think, notwithstanding month-on-month numbers, being slightly higher or lower, but I think you will see. There's been a tectonic shift in that space. In an agri orientation, we would look at seeds companies in a year where farmers are going to be, for want of a better word, pampered, whether through loan write-offs or through greater spends on productivity increase. I think seeds companies could be benefited.
Okay, so as you heard, both our guests, in fact, are very bullish on agrochemicals. Even Dheeraj said that he likes them, and Jake's just said that he likes the seed companies. But let's get some more views now. Nilesh Shah, the MD of Kotak Mahindra AMC, says the Karnataka elections and the monsoons are the key factors that will determine the next course of the market. Listen in.
The stock markets are likely to be volatile. While the downside is protected by improving earnings and improving micros, the upside also looks kept based on political uncertainty. And we yesterday had announcement of Karnataka election dates. And there are also global developments which kind of weaken our macros. Oil is on the upswing. Trade wars, whether it impacts us or not, but it's being negotiated upon. So we are looking at a choppy market, and in that kind of market, it will be better to continue your SIPs. And if you want to invest some larger amount, then please come by a systematic transfer plan over next 12 months rather than lump sum investment. It's far better to invest with longer term horizon and with the discipline of either the SIPs or the STPs. It's time to definitely look at large caps compared to mid and small caps. Titan, and while we are not allowed to talk stock specifics, so there's no recommendation to buy or sell or hold. It's all about trying to understand the phenomena. Clearly, there is a shift from unorganized sector to organized sector. Today, when we look at the share of organized or branded jewelry in the overall gold jewelry market, it's minuscule. It's possible that for years to come, this organized jewelry distribution companies can continue to grow at a very, very high speed. This is what happened with private banks. This is what happened with multiplexes. This is what happened with some of the FMCG companies. They continued to grow at a huge growth rate over a period of time, riding on the wave.
All right, so that's all the cues that one has to put on one's radar in the weeks and months to come. Thank you very much for watching this edition of Taking Stock. And from me and Sonia, have a great weekend, a long one.